Penguin Audio presents The How of Happiness, a scientific approach to getting the life you want. Written and read by Sonja Lyubomirsky, PhD. All of us want to be happy, even if we don't admit it openly or choose to cloak our desire in different words. Whether our dreams are about professional success, spiritual fulfillment, a purpose in life, or love and sex, we covet those things because ultimately we believe that they will make us happier. Yet few of us truly appreciate just how much we can improve our happiness, or know precisely how to go about doing it. To step back and consider your deep-seated assumptions about how to become a happier person is to understand that becoming happier is realizable, that it's in your power, and that it's one of the most vital and momentous things that you can do for yourself and for those around you. What are the meanings and mysteries of happiness? Is it possible to acquire more of it? And can new happiness ever endure? These are questions to which I have devoted my entire career as a research psychologist. When I was beginning my investigations as a 22-year-old psychology graduate student, the study of well-being wasn't a well-regarded choice. But recently, happiness has exploded as a hot topic in the social science community, with newspaper and magazine pieces, television documentaries, books, blogs, and podcasts on the topic, the vast majority of which are relatively uninformed by empirical data. Not infrequently, this frenzy drives researchers like myself to want to keep a distance. Yet I think it's essential to engage in the national discussion about happiness and insist that it abide by strict scientific standards. Why? Because I believe deeply in the importance of the scientific study of happiness and well-being. The majority of people in the world profess that being happy is one of their most cherished goals in life, for themselves and for their children. What's more, happiness offers myriad rewards, not just for the happy person, but for their family, workplace, community, nation, and society. I have been conducting research in this field for 18 years. Initially as a doctoral student at Stanford University, and now as a professor at the University of California, Riverside. In the intervening years, I have seen the science of happiness grow as part of a movement called positive psychology. The label comes from the conviction that empowering people to develop a positive state of mind, to live the most rewarding and happiest lives they can, is just as important as psychology's traditional focus on repairing their weaknesses and healing their pathologies. During the past 10 years, psychological science has made tremendous advances in knowledge about not only how to treat depression, that is, how to lift people from feeling terrible to feeling good, but how to elevate them to feeling great. We're in a new era, each month witnessing hot-off-the-press publications about how to achieve and sustain happiness, how to make life more fulfilling, more productive, and more enjoyable. Unfortunately, these findings are typically disseminated only among scientists, or else published in technical academic journals lying beyond the reach of the non-expert. In this book, I have assembled and interpreted the discoveries about how to become happier, using them as jumping-off points to teach skills that people can use to shift to a higher and sustainable level of well-being. Every suggestion that I offer is supported by scientific research. You can learn more about the studies that I describe in this book on my website, www.thehowofhappiness.com. Why should readers care about whether the advice they read in self-help books is supported by science? Because by applying the scientific method, researchers have the ability to disentangle cause and effect and to study a phenomenon without biases or preconceptions. Thus, if a magazine article proclaims that daily meditations make people happier, only a true double-blind experiment in which participants are randomly assigned either to the meditation condition or to a control group can determine if these claims are true. Although science is imperfect, we can be much more confident in its conclusions than in those of a single individual proffering advice based on his limited experience and assumptions. My friend and research collaborator Ken Sheldon and I received a grant for more than $1 million from the National Institute of Mental Health to fund research on the possibility of becoming happier. Along with a team of gifted graduate students, Ken and I have been using this grant to conduct so-called happiness interventions, experiments that aim to find out which happiness-boosting strategies are effective, and how and why. Our research suggests that enjoying a real increase in your own happiness is attainable if you are prepared to do the work. If you make a decision to be happier in your life, and you understand that this is a decision that will take effort, commitment, and a certain amount of discipline, you can make it happen. The How of Happiness is a book about how to become a happier person, supplying you a roadmap, a dozen happiness-increasing strategies for the way to get there, and for how to choose the strategies that fit you best. Backed by the results of our work with thousands of research participants, I deliver a theory of the determinants of happiness, a unifying theory that encapsulates everything that scientists currently know about what makes people happy. And essential to my idea that we can maximize our own happiness is the notion of the 40% solution. Why 40%? Because 40% is that part of our happiness that is in our power to change through how we act and how we think. It's not a small number, and it's not a huge number, but it's a reasonable and realistic number. The How of Happiness shows you how to apply that number to your own circumstances. First, I'll introduce you to the foundations of the How to Be Happier program described here, the theory behind the 40% solution. You will learn what most of us believe will make us happier, and in what ways we're wrong, and what scientists have shown actually determines happiness. At that point, you'll be geared up to begin introducing the thoughts and behaviors that will make you happier. You'll complete a fit diagnostic test that will flag which particular strategies will work to make you happier. This will direct you to what to take away from the next part of the book, which presents detailed analyses and concrete illustrations of 12 specific happiness-enhancing activities. The fit diagnostic test will lead you to those activities that apply specially to your personality, resources, goals, and needs. Contrary to popular belief, there is no one secret to happiness, just as there is no one miracle diet that works for all. Each of us needs to determine which strategy or set of strategies will be most valuable. Find your best fitting activities and begin the challenging but rewarding process of becoming a happier person. The last part of the book contains two vital sections. First, I'll describe 5 important hows behind abiding happiness, offering you insight into why the happiness strategies work. We know from the field of medicine that patients who have a good understanding of the thinking behind treatments are more likely to comply with them and benefit from them. The same logic applies here. A final section worth listening to, postscript, if you are depressed, is reserved for those of you who have been feeling sad or down during the last weeks. If this describes you, you may even want to listen to it first. I'll leave you with an observation. Some of us find exhortations to count your blessings, live in the present, look on the bright side, or smile trivial at best and corny at worst. Yet these strategies, when practiced in effortful and optimal ways, have been borne out in numerous studies to be incredibly effective. Why aren't they hip then? One reason, perhaps, is that such potent and complex happiness recommendations are not easily condensed or drawn down to their essence. Of course, we all would be happier if we truly and sincerely felt gratitude, but boiling down this behavior to, "Why don't you count your blessings?" makes the suggestion sound like a silly platitude. Or it may be that when we translate into a universal maxim something so personal, so close to the bone as how we wish to be or how we behave toward loved ones, the outcome sounds watered down, hackneyed, and cliched. However, you don't have to be the type of person who hangs quotations about happiness on her walls to experience the impact of what I'm trying to impart. Above all, understand that there are many faces of happiness aside from the ubiquitous smiley face and the inspirational poster. The face of happiness may be someone who is intensely curious and enthusiastic about learning. It may be someone who is engrossed in plans for his next 5 years. It may be someone who can distinguish between the things that matter and the things that don't. It may be someone who looks forward each night to reading to her child. In other words, we all have the potential to be happy, each in our own way. Growing up in both Russia and the United States, I've known some very unhappy people in my life. I've also witnessed more than one friend become and remain genuinely happier as she grew, changed, and matured. This book is the product of years of thinking, reading, and conducting research on how we can accomplish this feat. Whether you personally yearn to become happier, or you're intellectually curious about what scientists currently understand about the causes and potential for abiding well-being, I hope you will be enriched and enlightened. Part 1. How to Attain Real and Lasting Happiness. What do you think would make you happier? A relationship? A new job? A more attentive spouse? A baby? Looking younger, losing weight, more supportive, loving parents, cure from a chronic illness or disability, more money, more time, If your answers are anything like these, you're in for a surprise. None of these things will make you substantially happier. What we believe would make a huge difference in our lives actually, according to scientific research, makes only a small difference, while we overlook the true sources of personal happiness and well-being. You may have picked up this book because you believe that you're not living up to your potential in your personal or working life, or perhaps you're not as happy and fulfilled as you yearn to be. Nationally representative samples of U.S. adults indicate that 54% are moderately mentally healthy, yet not flourishing. That is,
we lack great. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.